Our next speaker, Mr. Markus Pfefferer. He's the Managing Director for Asia Pacific at Dato Worldwide. Markus has experience of business development across the diverse cultures of Europe, India, and Middle East and Asia. He has got experience in manufacturing process and heavy engineering, machine tools, construction, and automotive. I'm going to request Markus to come on stage. He's also going to be the moderator for our panel discussion on connected cars. Okay, so I will now in the next couple of minutes, in the next couple of slides, quickly touch upon a couple of global trends and global observations in the space of the connected car. Make it very high level, and then we can have pick up a couple of subjects maybe in the panel discussion following straight after this. So, as we heard already, and as we surely all agree, is that this is an exciting time in the automotive industry because the connected car will change the industry dramatically. It will, but only not change the industry alone, it will also change mobility as a whole, and subsequently the society, the way we live, the urban fabric as such. So, we have a couple of various issues or various subjects. One is the connected car in passenger cars. We heard already a lot about it today. Then we have a growing, and this is a fast developing sector, the commercial vehicles. And in commercial vehicles, we have very successful test runs in California for running trucks driverless. And this is something where we will see soon a breakthrough, and especially for countries which occupy last stage, which is US, and to a certain extent, of course, at some stage India. Autonomous trucks for interstate transport is something which is quite likely to happen very, very soon. And again, this will have huge of disruptive elements, because if you have a driverless truck, just imagine in the US alone, the truck industry or the transportation industry is the biggest employer in 29 of the US states. And then, of course, the on-demand ride-hailing, your Ubers, DDs, and not to forget all that. Here, as an important issue, what was discussed also before, also in the speech directly before, is how do you make the money? Where did the money in all this? And here are a couple of aspects where we can see money to be made or also lost. I mean, starting from infotainment. So soon you will have your infotainment apps, as we already seen in the Mahindra presentation, on your car already installed. That is definitely a possibility to make revenue. Then the car sharing industry is growing significantly. direct impact on revenue and money to be made. Then usage-based insurance. A gentleman from Capgemini already told us earlier that this they predicted, they had a study where they said this is the biggest way of revenue, and that is something which is also very interesting when it comes to data security. So there was in Germany, a place where I come from, a survey on data security, how ready is the consumer to share that data. And in Germany, where data security is very high, a lot of people were very reluctant to do it. Total opposite, for instance, to China, where people are very, very cool about their data, I guess mainly because they know already that the state knows already anything about them, so it's no point in pretending to hide anything. Whereas in Germany, the data security is really cool, it's very important, also for compliance issues and everything. So the level of readiness to share data was very, very low. At the same time, the moment you ask them or you imply that sharing data would also result in minimizing the premium on your insurance, this whole equation changed. The moment you put a money, a dollar or a euro on it, people are much more easier to share data. Once data is out, we all know everybody can do many things with data. Then there's the field of predictive maintenance, in-car payment. In-car payment is that you can pay for stuff, for tolls, for parking fees, directly with your car. Certain aspects of safety and security, of course, which will then lead to reduced accident rates. Reduced accident rates means, again, reduced insurance rates. And last but not least, location-based advertising. That's something which we will also see in the near future very, very soon. So all this is, of course, also bound to have the necessary infrastructure, and here a couple of aspects only which is important. I mean, what we will see is the rollout of 5G, which will have significant impact on drive a lot of these developments further in a much bigger speed than we all envisage. And what is also important, what I put here, the vehicle to grid, I think what we also always have to bear in mind that the ultimate vision, the ultimate goal of having self-driving cars, of having autonomous drives, driverless cars around, is always linked with the electrification of vehicles. Because for a driverless car, the electric motor is the best, or right now it's foreseen the best way to power these cars. And for them, then it's important to have this vehicle grid, where the vehicle can sees first of all the battery level and sees all the recharging stations and can synchronize with them and to make a seamless charge of the car, of the vehicle, possible. So the next couple of slides are just summarizing quickly, and I don't want to go into too much details on that because we are running a little bit time short of time, and also I would like to spend as much time as possible with my panelists. What I would like to stress here is that in the beginning of the year you have two important automotive events, or two big shows in the US. One is the classical Detroit Motor Show, and the other one is in Las Vegas, the CES, the Consumer Electronics Show. And in recent years, what we've seen as a trend is that OEMs spend much more on their stalls and on their presentation in Las Vegas than they spend in Detroit. And also more innovation is presented there. And very interested that this year, the connected cars were the biggest subject during the CES than video games. And as I said, these are a couple of things which I just mentioned here. Here's something interesting, and here we can just pick out one small issue here, the vanishing of mirrors in a car. Now, that shows what all can be involved and what can be impacted by connected cars. I mean, we all know that rear view mirrors in the last couple of years has seen a dramatic development of anti-fogging, of anti-reflecting. A lot of development went into it. The moment you replace all the mirrors with substantive element for you. And since one thing that was launched presented during CES in Las Vegas was the partnership between Ford and Amazon Alexa, and I guess there are a couple of Ford guys here, so they might be more than happy to explain this more in detail to you later on. But again, this is quite a natural and logical step that you then have a direct link between your car and your Amazon shopping lists or whatever, and the car can also pay the shopping list directly. Ultimately, of course, the car is driverless. The car will just pick up into the woods and deliver it home to your house. Now, as I said, we always have to talk about money at the end of the day, and here I wanted to show you what is the connected car penetration level right now in various regions, and what is the growth potential, and what is the growth prediction for the next 5 years. So I have put here Latin America, Asia, Europe, and North America. So while the biggest growth and the biggest penetration level will be in North America, followed by Europe and Asia, if you look at the right side, the right chart, this shows you the revenue opportunity in billion dollars. Revenue opportunity, and here it shows that we are sitting here all a bit in a sweet spot. In Asia, the revenue opportunity is estimated $53 billion US dollars. That is nearly as much as Europe and North America combined. And now it is up to us and you not just to find out the business model to capture on these revenues. Now again, a couple of words on the current situation here in Asia. So I mean, the most penetrated market already is of course North America, that has various regions, more openness to internet, also that the big internet firms, Facebook, Twitter, Google, Apple, etc., are all US headquartered. Then you have a less penetration level in Europe, again, various reasons. For instance, one reason is also the awareness and the reluctance of sharing data. And then you have a wide spectrum in Asia, from a very high penetration level in Japan to a very ambitious goals and targets in China, to a situation in India where we're still lagging behind significantly compared to other markets. So, and I put these figures here deliberately here, with the India figure of having just 2% connected cars in the passenger car segment and 1% in commercial vehicles. And I'm also predicting a rather slow growth or slow significant change of these figures. Now, here I'm playing a little bit also, let me be honest and fair, the devil's advocate. Because, and out of sheer personal reasons, because living in India, the biggest challenge and the biggest negative impact on our life is the traffic, let's face it. And the only way, or one significant way to improve the traffic situation is going forward into certain applications of the connected car, autonomous driving. So that this is in our own interest as we are consumers, not only as we are stakeholders in the industry, to get this development off the ground and to see significant change on Indian roads. So, as I said, we have. This is what it is right now. Around 2% in the commercial vehicle have telematics, and 2.4% cars sold in 2016 are with internet connectivity. So when we talk about connectivity, we talk about really two-way connectivity, not just that you can connect your phone via Bluetooth. While there is a lot of development happening here, there's a lot of as we heard, startups happening here. It doesn't trigger really down on the ground yet. And as I said, this is very significant, and also to one of the questions asked by Mr. Srinivasan earlier, is what does it mean for emerging markets, not only for India, but for any emerging development or emerging economy? Autonomous driving, self-driving cars, are a key element to improve living conditions in congested cities all over Asia. Because, I mean, it's very unlikely that huge infrastructure development will lead to a kind of penetration of public transport like you have in Europe or in other parts, yeah, in Europe mainly. So, but here you have something which the consumer itself can influence, and where private stakeholders can push these forward without needing too much investment from the government as such. Yeah, and with this I would like to end and invite, of course, my fellow panelists here on the stage. Seeing these figures, hearing these speeches, the question is what role does India really want to play?